In this video, we are going to talk about unique minimum variance unbiased estimator, or also known as minimum variance unbiased estimator. We are also going to study the following topics, that is the first being unbiased statistics, second sufficient statistics, then third is complete statistic, then fourth is UMVUE by Kramer-Rao inequality and UMVUE by Rao-Blackwell theorem. We are going to study these five topics, and also we'll going to look at some of the examples for these. Now let's move on to the first topic, that is unbiased statistic. What is unbiasedness? An estimator Tn is equals to T x1 x2 xn is said to be an unbiased estimator of gamma theta if expectation of Tn is equals to gamma theta for every theta belonging to script h, where our script h is the entire range of theta. Now this means that expectation of our statistics, that is so basically statistics is any function of x1 x2 xn, so expectation of Tn, that is our statistics in this case, which is a function of x1 x2 xn, is equals to our function of theta, that is gamma theta. Now let's look at one of the example on how to calculate unbiased statistic. So in this case, x1 x2 xn is a random sample where x follows normal mu comma 1, and we have to find the unbiased statistics for mu square plus 1. So we know that expectation of xi is equals to mu and variance of xi is equals to 1. Now expectation of xi square, so what is expectation of xi square? Is equals to variance of xi plus expectation of xi whole square. This is because variance of xi is given by expectation of xi square minus expectation of xi whole square. Now variance of xi is our 1 plus expectation of xi is given by mu, that is mu square. Now expectation of xi square is equals to 1 plus mu square. Expectation of summation of xi square is given by summation expectation of xi square, since our xi is a random sample and they are independent of each other, where I goes from 1 till n, which is equals to mu square plus 1 into n. So 1 upon summation of xi square, and if we take expectation of this, is equals to 1 plus mu square. So our unbiased estimator of 1 plus mu square is given by our t, which is equals to 1 by n summation of xi square. Now let's move on to the second topic, that is the sufficient estimator. So what is a sufficient statistic? A sufficient statistic is when if it contains all the information in the sample regarding the parameter, that is that our if parameter is equal to theta, if our x1, x2, xn is the random sample, then we know that all of the information regarding theta is contained in this particular sample. So let's look at the formal definition. Now let T be a sufficient statistic such that T is equals to T, which is a function of x1, x2 till xn, that is a random sample. Then PDF of x1, x2 till xn given T is independent of theta. That means that the PDF of the random sample given the sufficient statistic is independent of theta. That means that we have the full information of the parameter theta in a random sample x1, x2 till xn. Now let's look at the invariance property of sufficiency. Invariance property of sufficiency states that if T is sufficient for theta, then if xi of T is a one-to-one function, then we know that xi of T is a sufficient statistic for xi of theta as well. Now let's look at the factorization theorem for calculating the sufficient statistics. So factorization theorem states that T is equals to Tx is sufficient for theta only when it can be written in this particular form, that is our capital L, which is the likelihood function, that is the joint PDF of a random sample, is given by a function of Tx and is a function of Tx and theta only into a function of x only. So that is g theta of Tx into h of x. If the likelihood function can be written in this particular way, then T of x is considered as a sufficient statistic for theta. Now let's look at one of the examples for calculating the sufficient statistic using the factorization theorem. So we have f of x comma theta given by theta into x to the power theta minus 1, where our x ranges from 0 to 1 and our theta is greater than 0. Then let x1, x2, xn be a random sample, then find a sufficient statistic. So in this case, we have a likelihood function as multiplication I is equals to 1 till n theta into xi to the power theta minus 1, which means that theta into x1 to the power theta minus 1, theta into x to the power theta minus 1 till theta into xn to the power theta minus 1, which is equals to theta to the power n into multiplication of I is equals to 1 till n xi to the power theta minus 1. Now this can also be written as theta to the power n into multiplication I is equals to 1 till n of xi to the power theta minus 1. Now this can also be written as theta to the power n multiplication I is equals to 1 till n xi to the power theta into 1 upon multiplication I is equals to 1 till n xi. Now if you look closely at this, our g theta tx in this case is given by theta to the power n multiplication I is equals to 1 till n of xi raised to the power theta. This is our g theta tx, where our tx is multiplication I is equals to 1 till n of xi, and our hx is of this form. This is equals to our h of x and this is equals to our tx. So our sufficient statistics, that is our tx, is given by multiplication I is equals to 1 till n of xi. This is our sufficient statistics. This is our answer. Now let's also look at what Fisher-Neyman factorization theorem also states. So Fisher-Neyman factorization theorem states that if L is equals to multiplication of I is equals to 1 till n of f of xi comma theta can be denoted by g1 t comma theta into h of x, where g1 t comma theta is actually the PDF of t. There is a slight difference between the factorization theorem by Neyman and the Fisher-Neyman factorization theorem is that the function that depends on our sufficient statistic, that is t and theta, is actually the PDF of t in case of Fisher-Neyman factorization theorem, while in case of Neyman factorization theorem we already saw that it can be any function of t comma theta. Now let's look at one of the examples regarding how to solve the questions on Fisher-Neyman factorization theorem. So the example is that let x1, x2, xn be a random sample where x follows uniform 0 comma theta. Then we have to find the sufficient statistics for theta. Let's look at our likelihood function, which is given by capital L, which is the multiplication of the joint PDFs of a random sample, that is multiplication for I is equals to 1 till n into f of xi comma theta. Now this is equals to multiplication I is equals to 1 till n 1 by theta, since that is our PDF, which is equals to 1 by theta raised to the power n. Let our t be equal to capital of xn, that is the nth order statistics, that is the largest value in our sample. So let's also calculate the PDF of our xn, that is the nth order statistics. So it is denoted by f of xn, which is equals to n into capital F of x raised to the power n minus 1 into f of x. So we already know that our f of x is equals to 1 by theta, and our capital F of x is given by integrating 0 to x 1 by theta with respect to x, which is equals to x by theta. So our f of x n is equals to n into x by theta raised to the power n minus 1 into f of x, that is 1 by theta. Now this is equals to n into x raised to the power n minus 1 upon theta raised to the power n, f of x n. Now we know that our L is given by 1 by theta raised to the power n, and our f of t is given by n into t raised to the power n minus 1 upon theta raised to the power n. So our L can also be written as 1 by theta raised to the power n into t raised to the power n minus 1 upon n into t raised to the power n minus 1. Now this can also be written as 1 by theta raised to the power n into t raised to the power n minus 1 into 1 upon n into t raised to the power n minus 1. Now this is nothing but f of t comma theta, that is the PDF of t, and this is a function of our x since t is xn. So this is a function of our x, that is h of x. So this means that by Fisher-Neeman factorization theorem, we have our t is equals to xn as sufficient statistic for our theta. Now let's move on further to the next topic that we are going to cover in this video, that is the complete statistic. So the definition for the complete statistic is that if t is equals to t x1 x2 xn, that is a function of the random sample, be complete for theta if our expectation of h of t is equals to 0 for every theta, which implies that probability that h of t is equals to 0 is equals to 1. This also implies that our h of t is equals to 0 for every value of theta. Now let's understand what this means in detail. This means that if you are taking the expectation of ht to be equal to 0, h of t is basically a function of a random sample. So this means that our t is complete only if the expectation of h of t is 0 implies that our h of t is equals to 0. This means that we have the complete information about our random sample through h of t. Only then it belongs to the complete family of distributions. Now let's look at one of the examples on how to calculate the complete statistic. So let x1, x2, xn be a random sample such that x follows uniform 0 comma theta, then we have to calculate the complete statistic. Now let t is equals to maximum of xi, that is our cap x order n, that is our nth order statistics, that is the largest value in the sample. Now let g of t, like we saw in the earlier example as well, that it is equal to n into t raised to the power n minus 1 upon theta raised to the power n, where our t lies from 0 to theta. Now let's say that if expectation of h of t is 0 for every theta in this case, that is the expectation of h of t is given by h of t into the PDF, that is given by n into t raised to the power n minus 1 upon theta raised to the power n d of t is equals to 0 for every theta. To prove h of t is equals to 0 for every theta. Now we have to prove that if this particular equation is true, then our h of t is equals to 0 for every theta, and that is how we'll prove that t is a complete statistic. Now if you look at this particular formula, this is differentiation under integral sign with respect to z, where our limits also depend on z. So this is given by fundamental theory of calculus. So this is equals to this particular formula. Now using this particular formula, we'll also differentiate our equation, that is our 0 to theta h of t n t raised to the power n minus 1 upon theta raised to the power n dt. But first let's simplify this particular equation. So we get the constants out, n by theta raised to the power n, then we have integration from 0 to theta h of t into t raised to the power n minus 1 dt, which is equals to 0. This implies that 0 to theta h of t into t raised to the power n minus 1 dt is equals to 0. Now, if we differentiate this particular equation on both the sides, then we get, so let's look at the first term in the equation 1. So that is differentiation with respect to our z, that is our theta. So in this case, if we differentiate this particular function with respect to theta, we get 0. Plus, then we have if b of z comma z and derivative with respect to z of bz. So that means our h of theta into theta raised to the power n minus 1 and differentiation of theta with respect to theta gives us 1. And then we have minus of f of az, so f of az is 0. So this implies putting that value in the particular function, we get 0, which is equals to 0. Now we have h of theta into theta raised to the power n minus 1 is equals to 0, which implies our h of theta is equals to 0 for every theta, which implies that our h of t is equals to 0 for every theta. Hence, we have proved that since expectation of h of t is equals to 0, we get that h of t is also equal to 0 for every theta. Hence, t is a complete statistic. Hence proved. Hence, we get that t is a complete statistic, that is, our t is xn in this case.